Buenos días. I'm Marjorie Falster-Corellana, and I'm just going to introduce the speakers and moderate the next panel. I do just want to say, in the 1980s, I was one of those gringas. I was a college student who was politicized through the Central American Solidarity Movement, which was a small but quite impactful movement of people all around the U.S. who were working together to raise awareness of what was about what was happening in Central America at the time. And here in L.A., when I moved out to L.A., we organized a whole bunch of things. We did a tribunal at City Hall. We brought Rigoberta Menchú up to give her testimonio at City Hall. We held a walk. She slept on my couch. We did a walkathon where we walked with the names of the disappeared from Guatemala on banners. And house parties and all kinds of things. But the one thing I do want to say is that in that when we did all these events, I would usually look out on a room filled with gringos, white faces. And it's really wonderful to see the movement in this country and the growth of a whole generation of young Central Americans and or people interested in Central America. And we're in a different moment for that reason. And thank you to all of you for being here today.
Also, I wanted to mention that Marjorie is the Associate Director of the Center for the Study of International Migration here at UCLA. Ooh, thank you.
No worries. So it's really a delight to see this 35 years later. Here we are. Lots of the same challenges, but also a whole generation of young people, scholars, coming into being activists and ready to do some new work. So, voy a presentar a lo. Primero vamos a comenzar con Carmen Fernández Casanueva, ¿verdad? Sí. Casanueva, who's from the Centro de Investigaciones y Estudios Superiores en Antropología Social, o CIESAS, de México. And the bios, I should say, are in the back of the program, so I won't. And she is, talking on, Honduran immigrants in Chiapas from transit to settlement.
Okay. Good morning. I don't know, does this work?
Yeah, it does. Okay. Uh-huh. Well, I will try to speak in English. I prepare my presentation in English. But I'm going to do some remarks and comments in Spanish. So it's going to be a Spanglish presentation. Okay. The aim of the presentation is, first of all, to present a brief introduction of Honduran migration to and through Mexico, showing that their settlement in Mexico is not new. And that's exactly what I want to stress here. What we are looking at, what the media is presenting us, is not something new. Mexico as transit territory, but also as a settlement, is something that is not new at all. Also, I want to, considering that studies on migration usually categorize places either as transit or as destination places, and migrants either as temporary or immigrants or like settlers. I want to stress here that this is a blur line between being a transitory migrant or a transit migrant and an immigrant. And also to present that some places and some migrants fall into this blurry line between temporariness and permanency, and that the case of Honduran migrants living in Chiapas, but not only in Chiapas, is one of those cases. Well, the blue line dividing transit and settlement. Mexico has become increasingly committed to working with the United States. It's nothing new, as we were talking in the previous presentations. But now it has become even more clear and obvious that Mexico is working with the United States to administrate and block migratory flows in transit. This did not start after the arrival of the first caravan at all, but much earlier. Agreements such as Programa Integral de la Frontera Sur, established in 2014, and much earlier, at the beginning of this century, it has been pretty obvious for many of us. The Mexican government is committed to detain and deport migrants in transit to Mexico, through Mexico, and if they do hold the required, if they do not hold the required documents. These restrictive structural conditions complicates the understanding of, and the definition of what is transit migration. The increasing barriers to enter the United States, in combination with this increase of violence, deprivation of basic needs to survive in Honduras, put migrants into a situation of having to change their plans in places they did not mean to stay. Their original plans are usually to enter the American territory, but because of these structural conditions, they have to stay longer periods of time in Mexico, and during this time being deported many times, and as Amarela was saying, trying to cross the country many, many, many times. But during these times, this is not a line between A and B, but the time passed through during these periods of transit, they can stay for very long periods of time in different places. From a simplistic view of this phenomenon, we might wager that deported migrants are unlikely to attempt to migrate again once they have been returned to their places of origin. But, however, in the case of Salvadorans, Guatemalans, Hondurans, and now even more and more obvious other many countries such as Nicaragua, people from Haiti, etc., it's clear that this speculation is completely unrealistic. And considering that the high level of violence in the region is absolutely unlikely that they will stay in their countries of origin once they have been deported. Therefore, it is important to view transit migration as indefinite and uncertain, given that no one, neither the migrants nor the implementing the people or the states implementing policies, are certain of the length of time migrants will stay in those places, and that is something that is a fact and we have to address it. A location initially intended to be temporary stop can become a destination, while at the same time, a destination may also become a temporary place, all depending on a number of different factors. Focusing on the complex reality of Hondurans in specific, found in key locations along the route to the United States, particularly in Chiapas, which is the entrance, as you can see, this is a map of Chiapas divided in the regions. We can find Honduran people in many different regions, but in the main region that we find them is in this region called the Soconusco. This is the main entrance. They have become more. Han habido otras partes de Chiapas, donde obviamente encontramos muchos hondureños, pero esta es la región, digamos, tradicional y que sigue siendo relevante y es donde más se está concentrando, digamos, la presencia de la Guardia Nacional, por ejemplo, en este momento, ¿no? And so we have to recognize that not all migrants continue on their intended journeys. Not all migrants that remain in Mexico do so because they are stranded and trapped. This is also something very important. And not all migrants that settle have given up hope of the American dream. And once that they settle, not necessarily will necessarily stay and settle. They maybe can become, again, transit migrants. There is a growing population of people who transit through Mexico, and this is a transit slow, who have lived in at least one place in Mexico for months or even years. And we can talk to them, and many of them, they haven't lived only in one city, but they have lived in many different cities through Mexico. And now it's becoming a more obvious trend. But if we focus on the Hondurans in Chiapas, I've studied this immigration to the Soconusco in Chiapas for a long period, and that's what I want to focus. But before that, I can say that nevertheless we can identify some factors that seem to contribute to migrants' decisions to stay, either by it is difficult to decide. The ever increasing violence sending communities in Central America has become it is a journey completely. Volviéndose mucho más complicado migrar, la violencia no solamente en el lugar de destino, sino en el lugar de tránsito, se ha convertido en una situación que no es nueva, pero que es cada vez más obvia, y que por tanto, bueno, vamos a encontrar mucho más personas que se queden en territorio mexicano, y cada vez se tiene que considerar que este es un país de destino y no solamente de tránsito. Ahora, si nos enfocamos solamente a la migración hondureña en Chiapas, the majority of Honduran residents do not have the economic stability they imagine to achieve to go to the United States. However, after 20 years in which those places have received significant immigrants from Honduras, nationals from the country have encountered and shaped conditions that make settlement possible, at least for a certain time and to a certain extent. The immigration to Chiapas, particularly to the Soconusco, at the border with Guatemala, is linked to the immigration to the United States, at least at the very first moment. It is a mobility that has transformed not only United States and Honduras, but also an entire region, generating new dynamics in towns and cities of transit. And this migration clearly linked to the United States, to the migration to the United States, have also generated their own dynamic. And now that we can see that many migrants have social networks with people living in Chiapas, and they decided to migrate directly to Chiapas, to Tapachula, to Uistla, to different cities as their original plan, and not only because they failed to migrate to the United States. And that's one of the reasons I say that not all these migrants are stranded or trapped. We can also find many migrants that decide to stay there because of the social networks that have been built during these times. But interestingly, no one in Mexico was expecting the arrival of Hondurans. They do not have a cultural, social, and family ties with Chiapas as the Guatemalans have, as Marta will explain us later. They have not historically migrated there to work in the agriculture or domestic sector as their Guatemalans neighbors. They're supposed to just transit along Mexico territory. However, they stay. And this link with transit migration and the lack of historical roots and ties with Chiapas, with the Soconusco region, is what will shape their migratory experience along their stay. Even when structural conditions actually push them to stay, for local people, Hondurans, men, women, entire families more and more clearly now, are still labeled as transit or transitory migrants, even though they are there for years. Their main characteristics, who they are. Well, I started to study Honduran migration to Chiapas since, I will say, 2007. And obviously the things have changed a little bit. I will address these changes over the time. But since then, I would say that ages of people migrating usually are between 20, 54, with basic education, either single, traveling with groups, or traveling with children. And more it is very noticeable that they are traveling as a family, with groups of families. There are slightly more women than men for different reasons that I will not have time to explain now. Many women have left children in Honduras, and this geographic proximity between Chiapas and Honduras is an asset for them and one of the reasons they decided not to carry on with the journey. Many migrants have tried to migrate to the United States, but as I was saying, not all of them. And many women and men start a relationship with a local person, or another migrants, and have children born in Mexican territory. And that is also a factor where to decide to stay. This shapes the relationship with Mexico and plays a decisive role on their decision to settle. Even without the presence of children or native partners, it is common to find that migrants settle longer than expected. The decision to move is not an easy one. And also, even with Mexican children and local partners, it is not a fact. We cannot even say that they will never move. I have cases that even surprised me, like, oh, this woman will never move to the United States. She has a family here, a Mexican husband, Mexican children, and now they are here. No? They are in different places in the United States, and that's why say that it's very difficult to decide when the settlement, when they are immigrants and full stop, and when they are transit. It is a blur situation between transit and settlement. At the same time, they are unwilling and unable to return to Honduras, and now it's even becoming more and more complicated and difficult to take the decision to return. Well, when it comes, I'm going to present now some characteristics of situation, like spheres regarding their settlement that Hondurans have to face. Well, in the first place, if we talk about race, nationality, gender, the dimensions, how that shape Honduran settlement and integration, we have to say that it is interesting because we could not, as someone was saying here, to see like extremely differences between Central Americans and Mexicans. Like we will not say we are all mestizos and how that really happened. But yeah, there is la otredad, no? Even though we are all mestizos and you couldn't really notice a very strong difference between one and the other, there is a difference, and is the other one, the one that shouldn't be here, the one that should be just crossing our territory and leave, but they stay, and this is the other. And particularly for women from Honduras, they are considered exotic beauties, sexually liberal, household breakers, like las quitamaridos, and they are usually related to the bar and sex industry, whereas men are related to violence, are related to maras, and they are local people fear them. And now it's becoming more and more critical, this situation, because the race of number of people in these cities after the caravans. No? So that was, this is not new, but it's become more critical. And you can see that by reading local newspapers and radios, etc. This stigma that men and women from Honduras carry often blocks their prospects for employment and, in general terms, their economic and social mobility. If we talk about the essentials for surviving in a place as an immigrant, employment in particularly is immersed in informality. No? There are informal employments with working conditions that are not stable. They hardly any support of warranty against abuses from employers, because most of the people have not complete, fully documented, or maybe at some point they got a tarjeta de residente, but then they couldn't be able to, I mean, it was expired, for example, no? They get the tarjeta de residente for 1 year, and then this tarjeta expires, and it's not so easy to renew it. I'm going to talk about that later, but it's very, very complicated, so most of them are undocumented or in this blur situation of documentation. And of course, their employment has to be in this informal market. Activities related to commerce, service, construction sectors are the main activities that they engage in. Like, for example, waitressing, cooking, cleaning, attending clients at restaurants, small offices, hostels or shops, taking care of children, repairing shoes, cars, many different employments like this. Regardless of the fact that people think they el imaginario of women from Honduras are like they are sex workers. But this is not the only way to survive that women have. They have many other ways to survive, and many other, many women from Honduras that are not sex workers. Also are engaged in construction, and yes, in bars and sex industry, but not only. When it comes to access to migratory documents and birth certificate, well, there are many barriers that they have to face. First of all, the lack of information about the process to require documents, to acquire documents. The rights they have to obtain them and or the rights they subsequently obtain by having them. The Instituto Nacional de Migración officials, consulate staff, have failed to find more efficient channels and means to inform migrants about their rights and the procedures to obtain documents, and they also have insufficient resources to do so. Lack of time and money. I mean, all this process to get a document to remain with a legal status requires a lot of time. They have to go to make many different, it is a very long process and desgastante y difícil y muy caro. And many of them do not live in these main cities where the offices are. They live in different towns around the region, and then to go there and to make all this time. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm going to just wrap up. Anyway, I wanted to give a glimpse of their situation. The access to health, the access of education, it is a very complicated one if they are in this situation. But regardless of all that, they stay. Okay, I'm just going to skip the things, some of the things I wanted to say, because I have no more time. And just want to finish to make like final points, like to stay or to continue the journey. Well, some possibilities to find, possibilities to find employment to survive. There is the geographical proximity with Honduras, the social networks they create with local over time, coexist with unwelcoming and discriminatory conditions and difficulties to integrate themselves and their offsprings in an adequate fashion. While many build up attachment to the locality, deciding to stay, others feed their dream of a further migration even when they might never accomplish those plans. Structures favoring immigrants, integrating at times, block at other times. Migrants defining their permanency as transitory or temporary might change to define themselves as permanent settlers, and that definition might change over time. The migration from Honduras towards the United States encompasses many more factors than simply having the fortune of reaching the United States or the misfortune of being sent back. Between reaching the desired destination and the unhappy return, there is a journey that transcends the act of moving from one place to another. Migrants interact with other people they meet on their journey, including the places where they settle. Denying that the transit countries are themselves a destination is to ignore the logic of how people connect with other people and with places. And this is oversimplifying this reality, denying the urgency for an integration policy for those migrants in transitory status that could extend their stay over time, settling on a permanent basis. The answer to when a transition has become to its conclusion may never be answered completely. Even so, we must draw attention to the fact that migrants are made of people and not flows, and because of that, it is a very complicated issue to define. Under migrations in Mexico is a response of violence and poverty found within the places of origin and the restrictions encountered when trying to enter the United States, which result in places of transit becoming places where migrants settle. And well, I can carry on, but I'm going to leave it there. Thank you very much.
One question. I want to make sure we keep time. No, al final. Okay, vamos a continuar con Floridalma Bosch López from California State University, Los Angeles. And please remember the bios are in the back of the book. We will save time.
I'm setting my timer so I don't run out of time. So my name is Floridalma Boch Lopez. I'm an assistant professor of sociology at Cal State LA. It makes me so happy to see so many smiling faces. I just want to thank everybody who put this together. I was actually here at UCLA for the 2015 conference, and this is substantially bigger. It's a different type of speaker as well, which I think are all really great like growths and improvements for what we are building as a field and what some have been building for a while as a field. I do also want to just share that I'm Maya Quiche. My family's from Quetzaltenango, Guatemala, but I grew up here in LA. And I say that because I think so often we're talked about or our images are used in various presentations and we're not necessarily given the space to actually just have our own conversation as well. So with the small chance that there are Mayas out there in the audience, we're here together. So I think for me, a lot of what I ended up doing as my academic research was based on the fact that when I would do research about the genocide and the war and migration, it was such a heavy load for me to carry because of my personal attachments, because of my care and love for my own community and my people. A lot of my research actually ended up being on the ways that we respond, right? Because if the reality of migration is a necropolitics, then the reality is that for indigenous people, our politics are grounded in life, in persistence. And so that's what I wanted to document. I wanted to make sure that people understood that we weren't just victims and that we weren't silent, right? That being said, I will start with some historical context. So as was shared earlier, and I really want to drive home the point, that in Guatemala, it was not just a civil war, though that was definitely true there too. It was also specifically a genocide, right? And so it had very particular kind of racial impacts and policies. And I'll share why I think that's important in a little bit. But so yeah, some of the numbers have been shared. 200,000 people were killed. 40,000 people were disappeared, 1.5 million people were displaced, 93% of the violence committed was committed by the state, meaning like the military, the police, the paramilitary, the patrols, 83% of the victims were Mayan. But I also think it's always important to understand that the genocide and the civil war is part of a much longer historical trajectory, right? And so there's been more research kind of being done in the last decade or so that really tries to kind of name that. One of them is academics kind of thinking through a settler colonial framework, right? Because settler colonialism really helps us understand that when Guatemala becomes a country, it may say that it's founded on particular principles of brotherhood, whatever, but it actually doesn't lose its colonial structures, right? It just gets transitioned where the citizen is really kind of the legacy of the criollo colonizer. And so I think that's been really significant in charting the fact that across the political spectrum, whether it was like leftist revolutions or right-wing military regimes, they have all been hell-bent on eliminating indigenous people from the landscape of Guatemala in one way or another. And so I think that's kind of the contribution of a settler colonial framework. I also wanted to point out, and there I'm thinking like Shannon Speed, for instance, is somebody who's doing that work. There's also the four invasions model, right? And so thinking about Giovanni Bat's work, he's an anthropologist, and he did a lot of work in the Ishil region, and with communities who are organized there, kind of learned about this model of four invasions, right? Starting with Spanish colonization, up to coffee, banana plantations, the genocide, and now looking at mega projects and mining projects as a new kind of form of invasion. And I think one of the things that, you know, organizers have also pointed out is that we can also think about green infrastructure, right? Those projects that get sold to communities in Guatemala as being more environmentally sound as also a new form of invasion, because what they actually continue to produce is dispossession. And then also thinking more historically about dispossession, poverty, femicide, and corruption. And I think, especially when we think about poverty, right? So the first kind of presenter talked about how people would have left regardless, potentially. And I think it's important to understand that whether we're talking about war, or we're talking about mining, or we're talking about an intergenerational poverty that families can't escape, all of that is produced through state violence, by all of that is indigenous dispossession. And then also thinking about climate change, right? One of the, I'll be talking about this report in the next slide, but the International Mayan League, which is an organization housed in Washington, D.C., but that does really transnational work and has been doing so for decades, released a report. And one of their findings was that climate change is one of the driving forces, particularly drought, right? So we're talking about communities that are already really impoverished, that already deal with malnutrition, high rates of child malnutrition. For then there to be a drought that impacts la cosecha, right, what's possible in the harvest, it becomes a driving force for migration as well. But I think even climate change and drought, like, we have to acknowledge that as also a colonial consequence or a consequence of colonialism. And that's been documented through science, and I'm happy to talk more about that. And then I also wanted to talk specifically about migration to the U.S., because a lot of times what happens at the U.S.-Mexico border is that we're no longer considered indigenous, right? And so we automatically get placed by country of origin, though we have to understand that country as a settler state. And so it makes it really difficult to actually track kind of like how many of the migrants who are quote unquote Guatemalan are actually indigenous people. And so the International Mayan League did this report just a few months ago. You can follow them on Facebook and read it for yourself. They put it up publicly. And so they actually went down to the border and did interviews over the course of 2 weeks. And so one of their statements was, "We remain concerned that hundreds of thousands of indigenous people are not being accounted for because there is no disaggregated data on indigenous people within migration." Right, and so this is a challenge that I've had as somebody who tries to like think about this as a social scientist, but also not so grounded in an empiricism and what that can't necessarily, what that might not be able to measure, right? And so I've always had this like weird relationship with numbers, but there are some numbers. I won't say that it's always clear how those numbers are collected or counted. So for instance, I've seen reports that 50% of the Guatemalans who are migrants in Los Angeles are actually Mayan, right? I would actually think that that's pretty low, but International Mayan League and another report that they cite, when they were actually doing interviews with people at the border, about 30 to 37% of the people that they interviewed were indigenous people who spoke their indigenous languages. And so that's one of the key issues that they highlight, because they argue that, or they note this other report that talked about how for indigenous language speakers at the border, from the time that they're detained to the time that they're kind of being processed, they will experience at least a dozen different instances of discrimination because of the fact that they speak an indigenous language as their primary language. So we're talking about an entire structure that doesn't acknowledge them as indigenous people, which is a form of violence and actually violates, you know, international laws sometimes. And also that purposefully excludes them as indigenous people. And I think, you know, part of the conversation of thinking much longer historically is that people really act like the quote unquote crisis at the border and this whole like, it's indigenous people at the border is new, which is always frustrating because I'm like, how is interpretation a new issue? We've been dealing with this since the 70s and 80s, this issue of interpretation in particular. And so it's not new necessarily. They also noted that Mam, Canjoval, and Quiche are listed in the top 25 foreign languages most often spoken, right? And so there's a huge need for interpreters, but there is no response necessarily to fund interpreters, to pay for interpreter training, to clarify the structure so that when people do want to be interpreters, it's clear how they can do that. And I think ultimately all of this really obscures that part of what's happening at the border is not just xenophobia, but that it's layered with issues of racism. And then of course, in the US, some of those issues continue, right? So, like I already said, there's a huge lack of specific resources. There's really two organizations that I know of nationally that do very organized interpretive work, and both organizations are always seeking funding, right? They're always trying to resource their movement with staff. They're always caught up in trying to respond rapidly to like the raids in Mississippi. And so I think there's a real lack of resources for the people who are on the ground trying to do this work. I also think that there are institutions that I would expect more from, but I guess maybe I shouldn't. One of those are schools, right? So even public schools in LA, I've done teacher training, like teacher professional development workshops in different states, but multiple times here in LA. And what I find is so often schools are not creating institutional responses. They're really relying on individual teachers, like single teachers, to lead projects and be that change, which I think is a real burden on educators sometimes. That doesn't come with resources, it doesn't come with curriculum, it doesn't come with support. And I also think that we have to acknowledge that as people, as indigenous migrants, come to places like Los Angeles, we're also living in a site of what Maylee Blackwell terms multiple colonialities. And I think I also see that in the schools, right? So when schools also don't know how to teach about Native American studies and Native American issues, that does have an impact on indigenous immigrants. It's a possibility that isn't taken up. It's a possibility that gets erased. And then I also think there tends to be very limited space for Guatemalans and Mayans in particular to be part of these conversations, right? And I think I just recently joined Twitter, like actively, because so many young people are on there. And so I am seeing that like there is a push for specific Central American voices. And honestly, part of that comes from other Central Americans, right? So a Salvadoran journalist who makes the choice to like focus on Mayan migrants who are organizing, right? And tell the story about migration and detention through their perspectives. That is the kind of like shift in discourse that I really think makes a difference. And then of course, there's always the absorption into Latino categories, which, you know, can be strategic and can be useful sometimes, but also can be violent in its own ways. And so I wanted to talk about a community-based project that I did and really talk about where it comes out of, right? So I think it was 2017, I saw this image circulating online and like my head exploded, right? Because I felt like it was such a colonial and white gaze that I'm really familiar with, right? This tall, you know, blonde woman and the indigenous women, the artesanas, right, in the background. It speaks to issues of power, it speaks to issues of race, and, you know, what's interesting is that she's actually part Guatemalan, part American, the fashion designer, and her whole kind of enterprise was around elevating the textiles of indigenous women, and in return, giving them 15% of the profits so that they could buy filters to get clean water, right? And so part of what ends up happening is that in the US, all these business magazines and Latina magazines end up hailing her as this radical, like, Latina entrepreneur, right? Meanwhile, these are the optics that kind of pass through multiple hands and never get questioned. Of course, at the same time, the second image is also circulating, right? And the second image is of Mayan women protesting in the street through AFEDES, which is an organization that's really trying to get their weavings to be part of a collective copyright, right? And so they're out in the streets, mobilizing in the space that they're allowed to, and really claiming this ancestral practice for what it is, right? It is a relationship to the universe. It's a relationship to their elders. It's a relationship to their ancestors. It's one that they wear and they carry on their bodies. So it is theirs to defend. And so for me, these two images are circulating at the same time on social media. And I was like, this is exactly like the contradictions. And you know, you can question whether it is a contradiction, right? But these are the contradictions that I feel are such a part of Guatemalan politics, but also the limits of our understanding in the US when it comes to quote unquote Guatemalan migrants, where we don't necessarily understand that Mayan migrants in particular experience extreme forms of racism in Guatemala, and we have for generations. So I got really angry. And then So I developed a project, and I was like, okay, I'm finally going to do this. This had been sitting in my head, but finally I was able to like put it together and really commit to it. So what we did was I partnered with Las Fotos Project, which is an organization on the east side that exposes young Latina girls to photography as a means to document themselves, the issues in their community, and even to think about professional opportunities in photography and in content creation. So we recruited 6 Guatemalan high school girls. And then once a week, we would meet up, and I would do workshops. Las Fotos Project provided like technical photography training, which I did not have. And then collectively, we produced images that focused on Mayan women in LA, and we produced an exhibit. And so I also want to just point out that sometimes people see projects like this, and they think of it as cultural work, and which is one way of saying not political. Right? And I think, again, this is a misunderstanding of what it means to be Mayan in Guatemala. Right? And so one of the things that we posted up that we created was this poster, which is a quote from Irma Alicia Velázquez Nimatú when she was excluded from entering a restaurant because she was wearing traditional clothing. She wrote a piece about it. And so she says, whenever we are seen in regional traje, the ruling classes are reminded of their failure, of their efforts to make us disappear, which have ranged from genocide to ideological coercion. 5 centuries of humiliation have not succeeded in bringing the Maya people to their knees. And so I think this is about the ways that this embodied kind of indigenous geography is also, we fully understand it as a political act. We understand it as an act that might position us for being excluded, for being ostracized, for being violated, but we commit it nonetheless. And so I just wanted to show you a couple minutes of the opening so that you can feel or see a little bit of the vibrancy. Sorry, I'm going to have to fast forward. I don't have time. Okay, the video is available publicly, so you could go watch it if you want. And so I just want to talk a little bit about, you know, especially because this was supposed to organize around family, and I think for indigenous migrants, our conceptions of family might extend beyond what we think about biological family, right? To think about kinship, to think about ancestral relationships as well. And so, for instance, in this picture, you see a mother and her teenage daughter. I always love this picture because you can read the geography of their traditional clothing, but you can also, I mean, if you're from LA especially, I feel like you can read the geography of the house a little bit as being tied to South Central. I grew up there, so that's why it feels familiar. But I also want to point out that the young daughter, Jacqueline, is actually wearing her great-grandmother's corte. And so thinking about this clothing also as a site of connecting across generations, I think is critically important, and across spaces, right? Because we're talking about a practice that may begin in Quetzaltenango, but doesn't stop there, right? And doesn't stop because of migration. And then I always like sharing Marisela's quote, because part of what we also did was we gave the women themselves an opportunity to write their own captions, right? So if this is the picture, what do you want to share with the public about about who you are and what it means for you to do this. So I'll just read her quote. "More than representation, wearing my corte in Los Angeles is a responsibility. Knowing that I wear the stories, the life, the love of my ancestors is beyond powerful. It is tenacious, it is resilient. My ancestors, my grandparents, my parents have lived through colonization, wars, and genocide. Yet here I stand wearing the one corte that I own, the one corte that my grandmother and I share. That is resilience. By wearing my corte in Los Angeles, I am telling white supremacy, look at me. You tried to erase my existence, but here I am. My resilient ancestors prevailed." Oh, no, it's okay. I'll keep talking.
I was raised by my dad, too.
Unfortunately, I'm going to have to skip over that. But I also wanted to say that, like I mentioned at the beginning, you know, a lot of my work has tried to be anchored in the ways that we survive, persist, and respond. And at the same time, there is really no escape from the necropolitical, right? These politics of death that get wrought against our communities. So while this exhibit hung up and we had this beautiful, like, opening, Claudia Patricia Gomez Gonzalez was murdered by a Border Patrol agent at the same time. And so we ended up having to use the exhibit space to also create an altar to come together to honor her memory and her life. And I think that's something that, at least for me, both personally but also in my work, I'm still figuring out how to grapple with both, how to want to center life, joy, healing, in the face of the reality that they're still killing our communities. And then I also just wanted to note that we did end up taking the exhibit back to Guatemala, which was a really interesting experience, but one of the most meaningful aspects was that we got to connect with the space that works with deportees, that works with people who are thinking about migrating, and they gave us the most beautiful welcome, because they really understood kind of the context and the power of our work, because they were diaspora people in Guatemala. That's it. I'll stop there.
Thank you so much for that beautiful presentation, and I am so sorry about my phone. It's a new phone. I thought I fixed it. I'm not going to set the time for the next one. Okay. We are going to continue with Marta Luz Rojas Wiesner from El Colegio de la Frontera Sur.
Bueno, mientras me ponen la presentación, bueno, primero agradecer a Cecilia, a Lacey y a Rubén por haberme invitado a este evento para compartir con ustedes algunas reflexiones, pero sobre todo compartir también con los colegas con quienes tenemos intereses temáticos en común y que compartimos también preocupaciones genuinas por lo que estaba sucediendo en México, en la región y en general en América Latina y en el mundo. Acabo de venir del Foro Mundial de las Migraciones en Quito y la verdad queda uno en una situación que no sabe qué hacer. He preparado mi presentación para el tiempo que nos dijeron, entonces espero no pasarme, me voy a tomar el tiempo. En las dos últimas décadas, bueno, perdón, voy a hablar en español, discúlpenme, pero he hecho un translate supervisado para que ustedes puedan seguir lo que yo voy diciendo, va a estar atrás. Y discúlpenme si hay mucho texto. Bueno, en las dos últimas décadas, las medidas de contención migratoria encaminadas a frenar la llamada migración en tránsito por México han tenido distintas repercusiones en la vida cotidiana de mujeres y de hombres inmigrantes en distintas modalidades que viven o que trabajan en México, y en particular en la frontera sur. Me he especializado en la migración en esa zona. El objetivo de esta presentación es enfatizar en los efectos que las acciones derivadas de tales medidas restrictivas tienen, uno, en la vida cotidiana de mujeres guatemaltecas inmigrantes y sus familias sin documentación migratoria, quienes perciben mayor riesgo de deportación y se ven forzadas a restringir su movilidad diaria, así como el acceso a algunos servicios, como el de la salud sexual y reproductiva, que más recientemente tenía una preocupación especial por ese tema. Y bueno, y por otro lado, un poco ver qué pasa con la movilidad de los jóvenes guatemaltecos y las jóvenes guatemaltecas de 15 a 17 años, y luego lo voy a decir porque esa edad, que vienen a trabajar temporalmente a México y que se documentan con un permiso especial que se llama Tarjeta de Trabajador Fronterizo, y que han enfrentado restricciones para su documentación migratoria como trabajadores fronterizos. Y bueno, nos basamos en básicamente en entrevistas, pero también en datos que he recopilado en 20 años que llevo trabajando el tema, y en distintas zonas de la frontera, no solamente en la región del Soconusco, donde estuve viviendo casi 17 años. Las acciones restrictivas derivadas de la política migratoria en México han contribuido a la producción de migración en situación irregular, a la mayor probabilidad de deportación, lo que de Genova llama deportabilidad, a una mayor precariedad en su vida en general, no solamente es un tema de precariedad laboral, y más recientemente a exacerbar la xenofobia y la discriminación a lo largo de la llamada frontera sur, que como diría Jan de Vos, ni es sur ni es una sola frontera. Las acciones… el temor a la deportación ha generado incertidumbre e inseguridad, lo que ha incidido de distinta manera en la vida cotidiana de las personas migrantes, tengan o no tengan documentos, y eso hay que enfatizarlo, ¿no? En México se ha producido una mayor susceptibilidad a la deportación, hay una mayor detección, detención y de deportación. Hay distintos dispositivos o mecanismos que se han generado con ese fin, por lo que la probabilidad de deportación es creciente. Sabemos que las personas en tránsito usan distintas estrategias para no ser deportados, pero en ese contexto, las personas que no van en tránsito, ¿qué estrategias usan para evitar la deportación? ¿Cómo se mantienen en el estatus de no deportado, como diría el mismo de Genova? Bueno, en esta foto vemos algunos de los dispositivos de vigilancia que se han instalado gracias a Iniciativa Mérida y a otros recursos en algunas de las rutas de acceso desde la línea fronteriza con Guatemala. Esta es la entrada por la Trinitaria, viniendo por la Mesilla, por Huehuetenango, que se han instalado con cámaras, con lectores ópticos, con datos biométricos, etcétera, etcétera. Pero a nivel local operan otros dispositivos de vigilancia, control y disciplinamiento social. Las medidas de contención de la llamada política, que los que hemos pasado hemos puesto entre comilladas la palabra política migratoria, ya era restrictiva. La propia Ley General de Población en 1974, que es el antecedente más inmediato de la Ley General de Población de la Ley de Migración en 2011, era restrictiva y criminalizaba la migración sin documentos. Las medidas para controlar los flujos migratorios en la frontera sur de México empezaron a ser notorias en la década del 90 y en especial desde el año 2000, pero como apreciaremos en las tres diapositivas que siguen, eso no necesariamente fue así. Podemos identificar que desde la década de 1980 ya el control fronterizo existía. Cuando llegaron los refugiados, se devolvían a las personas que venían pidiendo refugio, y muchos de ellos fueron asesinados en la frontera por el ejército guatemalteco. A lo largo de toda esa década vamos encontrando distintos momentos. En el 88, por ejemplo, en pleno presidencia de Carlos Salinas de Gortari, preámbulo de la firma del Tratado de Libre Comercio, él se comprometió a la contención de migrantes centroamericanos y al tráfico de personas que iban rumbo a Estados Unidos. Y así nos encontramos entonces, por ejemplo, que en 1989, porque a veces decimos que se ha incrementado la deportación, pero por ejemplo, vean ustedes, en 1989 se deportaron 85 mil centroamericanos de México y en 1990 126 mil, que son cifras similares a hace apenas 2 o 3 años. Bueno, en 1973 se crea el Instituto Nacional de Migración como un instituto descentralizado, no quiere decir que no existía, Para los que, yo por ejemplo soy colombiana, vivo hace 30 años en México y yo pasé por la externalización de la frontera desde ese entonces, pero también por restricciones para la documentación. Nosotros éramos una de las tres nacionalidades que en México estaban establecidas porque habían reguladas, que son las que sacan el documento, las liberadas, que no sacan ningún documento, y las restringidas, que éramos los colombianos y una serie de nacionalidades que teníamos que pasar a un piso especial para hacer los trámites de documentación. Y justo en el contexto del Tratado de Libre Comercio, y eso tiene que ver con la migración guatemalteca fundamentalmente, se comienzan a dar los primeros ordenamientos, la gestión migratoria, ordenar, regular la frontera sur, y en particular con la expedición de los permisos para trabajadores agrícolas, que en ese entonces se expedían de manera colectiva, pero a partir del año 1997 se expidió la primera forma migratoria para visitantes agrícolas. Y luego, pues en 1998 hubo un programa especial de sellamiento, así se llamó sellamiento de la frontera sur. Y luego en el 2000 encontramos distintas expresiones de las firmas de memorandos, de acuerdos intersecretariales para la migración segura y ordenada y distintos mecanismos de sellamiento de la frontera que se fueron haciendo notorios cada vez que discutíamos algunos de los planteamientos que hacía el gobierno. En 2005, por ejemplo, el Instituto Nacional de Migración reconocido como instancia de seguridad nacional, y allí la securitización entró a la palestra como un tema prioritario. Y también en ese año se estableció la primera iniciativa de política migratoria para la frontera sur, que digamos fue el segundo momento de ordenamiento de la llamada frontera sur a través de la expedición de algunos documentos de visitantes, no para residentes, para esa zona. Y bueno, nos encontramos el tan mentado y mencionado programa en la siguiente década, que algunos le llaman Plan Sur, pero en realidad se llama oficialmente Programa Integral Frontera Sur, porque tenía una estructura programática de asignación de presupuesto, y por eso se llama programa, en distintas entidades que todavía hoy funcionan algunas en la Coordinación Integral para la Frontera Sur. Y que bueno, y ahí entonces encontramos la clara expresión de las famosas 3Ds que lo decía Jan Jarab, de la Oficina de Naciones Unidas para los Derechos Humanos, que hablaba de la detección, de la detención y la deportación. Pero también se comenzó a sumar en ese momento otras Ds que podríamos llamar la política entonces de las 5Ds en español. Bueno, traté de buscar en inglés cuáles eran. La disuasión, que es otra que se suma, y la dilación. Te disuadimos, no entres, te vas a tardar tres meses, no, espérate, mejor regrésate. Y la dilación, alentar los procesos hasta que la gente desistía. La mayor parte de las no aprobaciones de las solicitudes de refugiado terminan en rechazos, por un lado, pero en la mayor parte son desistimientos o desistimientos de los procesos. Y bueno, al final de ahora lo que estamos viviendo es una política de control que se funda en una lectura tóxica, si queremos llamarlo así, del Pacto Global para una Migración Segura y Ordenada y Regular, que es el lema que se utiliza en la caravana. Lo vimos con la subdelegada de migración del Suchiate, la licenciada Paola, esgrimiéndole a los caravaneros, como diría Amarela, que estaban apegándose al Pacto Global que se había firmado. Resulta que no es vinculante, pero resulta que sí es vinculante en la práctica, ¿verdad? Entonces, lo que encontramos es un nuevo sellamiento para la frontera. La externalización de la frontera, de la que ya se ha hablado acá, se combina ya no con cinturones que de pronto se establecieron con el Plan Sur en el año 2001, que era en la línea del Golfo, sino que ahora son franjas de contención y franjas de la llamada tolerancia. Te permito que circules, pero hasta aquí no más, ¿no? Entonces, eso digamos es un cóctel que podemos encontrar: el ordenamiento de la frontera sur, más la administración de flujo, más la contención migratoria, que ha derivado a lo largo de estos años que les acabo de mostrar. Uno, primero la demarcación de cinturones, que fue muy clara en el 2001, y luego pasamos a la externalización de la frontera. Ya desde el 2001, el padre Flor María Rigoni hablaba de la frontera vertical, y Hugo Ángeles, investigador del Colegio de la Frontera Sur en ese entonces, hablaba de la frontera elástica. Esto que decía Marina, que de pronto se retrae, es una frontera que se retrae o se contrae o se estira según la situación. Y nos pasamos ahora a una combinación de una externalización de la frontera en los distintos países, más estas franjas amplias de contención, tanto en el norte como en el sur. Sin duda, estas acciones han incidido en las deportaciones. En esta gráfica podemos ver algunos de los picos de los montos que están relacionados con la combinación, no solamente de contención, hay también algunas son relacionadas con afluencia, pero hay una combinación de afluencia. Esto es en el año del STAN, mayor presencia, control, o sea, había más gente, más agarraron. Y en esta de acá, que es la del 2014, es básicamente control. Este es fundamentalmente control migratorio, porque no fue tanta la afluencia de migrantes. Y aquí, que ya se comienza a elevar el pico, me faltó el año 2019, una combinación entre control y afluencia, que está, digamos, un poco baja por el tema de las que están ahora en proceso de solicitud. Y bueno, y lo que encontramos es que aunque en el movimiento, en lo que en demografía llamamos los flujos migratorios, la presencia de las mujeres es menor, ustedes lo ven acá, en la gráfica de abajo, esta es la de hombres y este es el total, aunque es menor, curiosamente aquí uno puede hacer varios análisis, porque aquí la de los hombres bajó un poco y aquí la de las mujeres subió el número de deportaciones. Lo que encontramos es que a lo largo de esta década ha ido incrementándose la proporción de mujeres que son deportadas, lo cual nos da algunos indicios, hay varios análisis que hemos hecho de la mayor presencia, y de hecho si uno hace un análisis a través de los llamados stock de las personas que ya están viviendo en México, uno encuentra que las migraciones centroamericanas son feminizadas, como le dirían algunos. Casi el 57% de las mujeres que en ese momento viven en México, que son guatemaltecas, son mujeres guatemaltecas, perdón, casi 57%. Casi el 62% de la migración salvadoreña son mujeres. Y casi el 59% hondureñas, son casi el 57% las guatemaltecas, que es 57% de los salvadoreñas, el 61% que ha sido siempre una población muy feminizada, y luego las hondureñas que van acercándose al 60%, lo cual nos da pues muchas pautas para plantear hipótesis. Y bueno, pues el temor a la deportación de las mujeres inmigrantes ya establecidas en estos estados se ha incrementado aún en las localidades aparentemente lejanas de las rutas principales de entrada. Si tú no se puede encontrar mujeres viviendo en localidades perdidas en el mapa de la República Mexicana, en los confines, y allí están tratando de llevar una vida de discriminación, etcétera. Bueno, en este contexto, entonces, de contención migratoria y de reescalamiento del control, ¿qué ha pasado? Ya lo he dicho de alguna manera en todas las diapositivas, ¿qué ha pasado? Ha habido una mayor criminalización de la migración y los migrantes, un incremento en el número de deportaciones y una mayor probabilidad de ser deportados, un miedo a la deportación que genera estrategias de afrontamiento, una mayor vulnerabilidad a otros riesgos y una mayor precariedad. Las mujeres inmigrantes de origen guatemalteco en particular, que viven en estas localidades fronterizas con Guatemala, buscan diferentes estrategias para pasar desapercibidas. Generalmente son de pasar invisibles, ¿no? De no salir, de moverse en tramos cortos, por lo general en condiciones precarias y con poca movilidad, pero sobre todo muy solas y con un gran desamparo institucional, por ponerlo de alguna manera. Porque en muchas de estas localidades ni siquiera existen organizaciones de la sociedad civil, la mayor parte de la sociedad civil está focalizada en Tapachula, en el resto no encuentran una organización de la sociedad civil ni otras personas que lo acompañen. Porque hay quienes han dicho que hemos tapachultequizado, nos hemos enfocado en Tapachula, o hemos chiapanequizado, nos hemos enfocado en Chiapas, en el estudio de las migraciones en la frontera sur, pero hay realidades en otros lugares que son verdaderamente preocupantes. Entonces, bueno, las medidas de control migratorio, por tanto, el miedo a la deportación ha limitado la posibilidad de que las mujeres puedan buscar atención médica en alguna localidad fronteriza en Guatemala, y quiero llamar la atención sobre el tema de la salud sexual y reproductiva. Las mujeres tradicionalmente iban a parir a sus hijos a Guatemala porque no les costaba, en Chiapas les cobran por tener un hijo, pero además les piden unidades de sangre para que tengan un menor costo. Entonces, las restricciones a la salud y a otros derechos constituyen parte de una problemática cotidiana que se enfrenta en esos contextos de discriminación y construcción de una otredad, que ya había dicho Carmen, que suele excluir y criminalizar a las personas migrantes. Bueno, y quiero mencionar algo muy rápido, porque ya tengo 15 minutos, me faltan 4 minutos de mis 20. ¿Cuál es la situación de los adolescentes que llegan por temporadas a trabajar a localidades fronterizas? Hasta 2003, los menores de 18 años de Guatemala se podían documentar de manera independiente con un permiso migratorio de como trabajador visitante, aunque venían en colectivo, y después se expidió una tarjeta especial para ellos. Después del 2003 ya no, empezó a haber un mayor control, empezó a haber una mayor exigencia de documentos migratorios junto a las restricciones a la edad para la documentación migratoria de forma independiente, e incidieron, que incidieron negativamente para cruzar la frontera. En México se supone que la edad mínima para trabajar es de 15 años, ¿sí? Y está establecido por ley que las personas de 15 y que no, todavía no han cumplido los 16 tienen que pedir un permiso a los padres y a los tutores para poder trabajar. Pues el Instituto Nacional de Migración estableció sus propios criterios para el ingreso de jóvenes de 15, 16 y 17 años que tienen que pedir, además de varios documentos, un permiso de los padres, pero el permiso no es cualquier permiso, tiene que ser firmado por un notario. Imagínense ustedes a una familia de Concepción Tutuapa que tiene que caminar 12 horas para llegar a la frontera, que vayan a firmar. Pues eso en qué derivó, y me voy a pasar un poco rápido, eso derivó en que muchos decidieron ya entrar a las fincas sin documentarse, entonces se incrementó la migración irregular, y por otra parte, muchos de los jovencitos decidieron cambiar de giro, ya no ir a las actividades agrícolas, y entonces hacen unos grandes rodeos para poder llegar, para poder burlar a la migra. Una etiqueta, una denominación que no existía hace 10 años. Ahora se habla de la migra, ¿no? Y hay que burlar a la migra. Y bueno, y los chicos son bastante ingeniosos, y no quiero abundar en eso. Bueno, yo les quería mostrar, presentar la ilustración de Marina, pero lo voy a narrar. Quería hablar sobre Marina, que es una historia simple de una persona que quizás no tenga muchos eventos dramáticos en su vida, pero es la historia que viven las mujeres cotidianamente, sean salvadoreñas, hondureñas, nicaragüenses, ahora cubanas, haitianas y todas las demás nacionalidades que están presentes ahora en la región, y que justamente por las restricciones el mayor control, antes podían pasar el puente del Suchate, ir a Tecunumán a atenderse. Sus dos primeros hijos tuvo que pasar de manera clandestina, ya prácticamente con las contracciones, para poder ser atendida en Guatemala. Y regresar de la misma manera clandestina por el río con los bebés recién nacidos. Y entonces, este caso lo sé muy bien porque me invitaron a una reunión para ayudarles a buscar la regularización migratoria. Es supremamente difícil la regularización de ellos porque tienen tres opciones. Una es esperar a que el tercer bebé, porque estaba embarazada, nazca, y que nazca en México, porque ella fue a parir a Guatemala porque no tenía dinero, y esperarse todo el proceso para naturalizarse, y luego por unidad familiar, primero documentarse, naturalizarse, y luego poder documentar a la niña, porque la preocupación era porque su niña mayorcita, que tiene 6 años, ya tenía que entrar a la escuela. Y el segundo punto, que es muy generalizado, la segunda opción, es procesos apócrifos de documentación migratoria, que es algo muy extendido desde el Pacífico hasta el Caribe, en la frontera con Belice. Bueno, me paso ese. Y entonces, bueno, esa preocupación por el tema de la salud sexual, pero de otro tipo de saludes, de temas de salud, más el de la educación, y no quiero mencionar todo lo que dicen los niños que se sienten discriminados en las escuelas, porque si no me daría para otra ponencia. Y bueno, pues entonces quiero terminar diciendo que el énfasis en la amenaza del crimen vinculado a las políticas migratorias, el control fronterizo, ha desencadenado estos procesos que hemos insistido de la autoridad. En la vida cotidiana constantemente sale el fulano que le machetea el guajolote, el pavo, a la vecina que es guatemalteca, porque es una, perdón la expresión, es una pinche guatemalteca, y así la expresión, y aquí no debes estar. El odio que hay en algunas localidades hacia la población guatemalteca es verdaderamente preocupante, exacerbada por el discurso, la retórica reciente de los migrantes que nos están invadiendo en nuestro país. Y bueno, solo quiero terminar con esta diciendo que la reciente presencia de la Guardia Nacional y de las autoridades que vigilan las fronteras también se ha constituido en un obstáculo, porque si antes se podían ir de manera clandestina, ahora ni de manera clandestina se pueden ir las mujeres a parir a sus hijos y atenderse, o el Papa Nicolau, hacerse las revisiones cotidianas de su salud sexual y reproductiva. La xenofobia y la discriminación en general se han exacerbado con efectos en quienes participan en las distintas modalidades de la movilidad en un país que puede dar un giro a su política de acogida y de integración. En un país que en el año 2015 habían 79 mil personas centroamericanas en el stock de migrantes, habían 79 mil personas mexicanas que representan el 0.06% de la población de México, que son 126 millones de personas. Es inaudito que nos estemos preocupando por eso que han llamado algunos las hordas de migrantes, y además las hordas de migrantes que vienen enfermos, que vienen vienen con hijos y que además vienen desempleados. Hay un imaginario que se está volviendo perverso, tóxico, que debemos parar de alguna manera. Y ese, digamos, es parte de los esfuerzos que hacemos algunos académicos que participamos. No solamente trabajamos en la academia, varios de los que estamos acá, sino que también participamos con las organizaciones de la sociedad civil para tratar de incidir en un cambio. Entonces, bueno, pues eso es lo que quería decir. Gracias. Gracias.
Gracias a todos, todas. Y tenemos tiempo para algunas preguntas. We have 10 minutes. Questions for any of the panelists. Or comments, conversation. One, two.
Yes, I have a question for both panelists. I'm trying to ask about how the Guatemalan immigrants are perceived or how they negotiate their identity, especially their indigenous identity at the border. And if you can give us some insights.
Por favor, si es para mí, me la traducen porque...
La pregunta era, ¿cómo es que las mujeres en particular, los inmigrantes de Guatemala, cómo negocian su identidad cuando en el área fronterizo? Right? Did I get that? Yeah, the indigenous Guatemaltecas.
Por lo general, hay una cosa en particular con la migración guatemalteca, y es que no hay que olvidar que Guatemala... es el país vecino, pero además toda la región de Chiapas y Campeche y eso fue parte de Guatemala. Entonces hay una historia de familiaridad, hay vínculos familiares que aún subsisten. Yo, muchas de las personas que yo he entrevistado tienen a su abuela, a su tío, todo lo demás. Y entonces con este tema de la securitización, se ha dicho, por ejemplo, de algunas imágenes que están algunas chicos o chicas, que por ejemplo, no sé quién conozca, quien haya ido a Siscaba, al lago de Montebello, muy claramente puede darse cuenta que hay un punto en el que no sabes dónde estás. Está ahí porque está la mojonera, ¿verdad? Está el mojón, la columna, o está el lago internacional que tiene unas boyas, que está muy bonito, pero tú puedes pasar, entrar y salir por cualquier lado de esos. Entonces, cuando se habla de que se han incrementado los puntos informales de internamiento, la verdad uno dice, pero a ver, ¿dónde? Cuando hablan de la frontera porosa, la verdad a mí me da escalofrío. O sea, no hay una frontera porosa porque hay tantos vínculos que decir frontera porosa es calificar que la frontera tiene un límite, una demarcación internacional. Yo estoy en contra de usar la palabra la permeabilidad de la frontera y la porosidad de la frontera. Por favor, si aquí de este lado y de acá, hay un lugar que se llama Niquivil y Chihuaté, en la parte alta de Tapachula. Niquivil le da a Chihuaté, Chihuaté porque está pegado Chiapas de Guatemala, le da el agua y el otro le da la luz. Y sabes que estás ahí en la frontera porque las mojoneras pasan exactamente así como retorcidas pasando por la mitad del pueblo. Entonces, tenemos que, bueno, sí, ahí, yo estoy de acuerdo en que sí se debe facilitar en las zonas en las que se necesita entrar, por ejemplo, para entrar por el Suchate, tienes que pasar o por el río o por el puente. Y hasta hace 10 años podíamos pasar por el puente sin ningún problema. Sin ningún problema los que vivíamos ahí. Pero ahora no, ahora tienes que hacer check-in para entrar y check-in para salir. Y entonces, ¿qué hacían, por ejemplo, las trabajadoras domésticas? Las trabajadoras domésticas pedían un pase local por 72 horas que les sellaba la migración guatemalteca. Pasaban y tiraban el papelito y después regresaban al mes o a los dos meses. Y así era la cotidianidad. Ahora es más restrictivo, ahora hay una tarjeta de visitante regional, que ese es otro tema para hablar, no me quiero extender aquí porque las compañeras también quieren hablar, con las que se ha entonces querido regularizar la migración con tarjetas de visitantes cuando hay personas que llevan 30 años viviendo en la región y no tienen acceso a un documento. ¿Por qué? Porque si quieren regularizar a la familia les cuesta casi 40,000 pesos. Y no pueden, no pueden. Cuando se ganan recogiendo basura, tratando de sobrevivir escasamente, no sé, 1,200 pesos al mes.
I think in terms of the U.S.-Mexico border, there's a lot of research that's documented kind of the ways that people try to survive. It's everything from not wearing traditional clothing, right, so that they're not as easily marked as being Guatemalan, trying not to speak their language, doing the best they can to speak Spanish, so again, that they're not additionally marked. So I would point to that research that has been published pretty much since the 90s because the conversation isn't new.
Bueno, yo también quiero comentar algo un poco en relación a, aunque no presenté el tema de Guatemala, pues eso, lo que decía Marta, ¿no? Hay una vida cultural, económica, social en la frontera que no se puede entender sin ir al otro lado, ¿no? Tanto de un lado como del otro, y hay un intercambio de estrategias. Por ejemplo, hay muchos comerciantes mexicanos que van a comprar su mercancía a Guatemala, la pasan por el río, pero ellos se pasan por el puente y viceversa, ¿no? No nada más tenemos que pensar en un flujo de sur a norte o de Guatemala hacia México, sino que hay un intercambio entre Guatemala, México, México, Guatemala, en muchos sentidos, ¿no? Comercial, laboral, etcétera. Y que claro, cada vez está más restrictiva el flujo y las estrategias continúan, o sea, las estrategias para seguir reproduciendo la vida local transfronteriza, pues van a seguir, ¿no? A pesar de todas las restricciones.
Muy buenas tardes y muchísimas gracias a ustedes tres por sus presentaciones tan informativas. Tengo una pregunta para las tres de ustedes porque de una manera u otra habían hablado de la necesidad de colaborar con los grupos que ya están haciendo estos tipos de trabajos. To quote la doctora Boj López, she said, "We will be dealing with trauma for generations, but we have to support the institutions that understand us." Entonces, mi pregunta es, ¿a dónde podemos empezar? ¿Cuáles son estos institutos y cómo deberíamos de colaborar para llegar a esta meta? Gracias.
Bueno, llegar a una meta, a veces siempre nos preguntan, ¿y cuál es la solución? Pues no es una cosa tan fácil, la verdad. Lo que se puede hacer, o sea, en la medida de nuestras muy limitadas posibilidades, es trabajar de la mano con organizaciones, incidir en la medida de lo posible. Nosotros ahí, pues, en la medida de lo posible, humildemente, hemos siempre tenido como ese impulso de trabajar en colaboración con organizaciones que están, organizaciones de base, que están en el terreno, que tienen los pelos de la burra en la mano, como dice Marta, y trabajar con ellos, ¿no? En un intercambio siempre colaborativo, ¿no? Nosotros como académicos no separarnos de lo que está pasando, de la gente que está al pie del cañón, esa es la única manera, ¿no? Y digamos, impulsar la discusión, levantar nuestra voz, desde la academia también es importante, ¿no? Desde el análisis, porque de alguna manera nuestra posición nos da cierto, muy comillado, privilegio de poder decir, bueno, yo hice tal o cual estudio, pues utilicémoslo, más allá de escribir papers, también tenemos que utilizar esas herramientas para poder incidir, aunque sea poco, pero estar ahí y nunca desistir, seguir aunque te desespere y sientas como una gran decepción de lo que está pasando, pues siempre seguir, ¿no?
I also think collaborations are important, but they have to be anchored in the perspectives of the communities that are facing these issues. I always say, like, our perspectives have to be centered because we literally carry this history and this experience on our back. And so I think there are, and I always want to have this like centralized like list of like social movements, organizations, projects that are doing this work. And then I have to like check myself to not like feel like if it's not centralized, if I don't have a list, then it doesn't exist, right? It does exist. I'm thinking of like the teacher professional development workshops that I've done in LA. They're all through an Ethnic Studies for All initiative. And they've actually been seeing more migrants who are indigenous, typically from Guatemala or from Oaxaca, in their classrooms. And so they reached out to me to try to understand, like, why are people coming? What are the needs? And so I think that's part of the initiative. Like I said, I really, really like that this Salvadoran journalist, Daniel Alvarenga, yeah. I hope I'm not saying his name wrong, you know, did a whole piece around the children that were dying at the border, right? Or Tiki Chakalinkal. And who did he contact? He contacted International Mayan League, who has been doing this work for decades, and centered kind of the conversation and did it in collaboration to the point where it was about what story did they want to tell. It wasn't just, let me ask you the questions. It's what questions should we be asking? What data needs to be out there? How do we complicate our understanding, right? And then that video ended up being released on Indigenous Peoples Day, which I think is incredibly meaningful. So I think there's a lot of opportunities, and I think it's about thinking what resources can we contribute and how do we do it humbly, always centering the people who live that experience and especially the organizers. And I think even Jennifer's film is an excellent example of that, right? She talked to the organizers, she talked to the people who are existing in those detention centers or did for a while. And I think that's kind of the model to follow.
Es una pregunta un poco difícil, pero yo creo que en los últimos años yo me he sentido como, muchos de nosotros nos hemos sentido como Penélope tejiendo. Tejemos y destejemos, tejemos y destejemos. Creíamos que habíamos avanzado en los 10 años en la incidencia de la sociedad civil para mejorar mecanismos, para ayudar a diseñar el programa especial de migración, pero todo eso se fue al traste y ahora hay que volver a construir. Y la única manera de volver a construir es rearticularse, porque lo que ha pasado también es que, por ejemplo, la sociedad civil con la academia a veces ha tenido choques. También es por los estilos que tenemos de un poco de colonialismo, ¿no? como diría Amarela, de llegar a imponer estilos de trabajar. Y la verdad nos tenemos que sentar a escuchar y a trabajar de manera coordinada. Y yo siempre lo he dicho, tenemos que ser la gota que orada la piedra. Quizás son avances pequeños, pero tenemos que ir avanzando. Y lo importante es estar allí dispuestos a hacerlo, porque evidentemente demanda tiempo, demanda estar allí, ¿no? Entonces, bueno, yo creo que sí se puede hacer, que podemos tener buenas colaboraciones. Ahora, por ejemplo, a veces algunos de los académicos les da un poco de, vuelvo a usar la palabra escozor, sentarse a discutir en los consejos consultivos o en los consejos ciudadanos de algunas instancias como el Instituto Nacional de Migración, el Consejo Consultivo de Política Migratoria. Pero yo creo que tenemos que ejercer la ciudadanización y tenemos que estar allí, tenemos que confrontarnos, enfrentarnos, resistir y seguir siendo la gota que ora la piedra, ¿verdad? Porque no es fácil. Y la única manera de visibilizar es eso, ir a terreno. Nosotros, yo por ejemplo, he tenido el privilegio de ir a los confines de México, al el ejido más alejado de México, que es la frontera con Belice y Guatemala, que la gente está olvidada. Olvidada. No es un tema solamente de los migrantes, es un tema también de las personas que están en sectores que están excluidos y marginados, mexicanos también. Entonces tiene que ser una consigna, digamos, de trabajo de considerar a migrantes y a no migrantes como sujetos sociales y políticos, y a lo mejor no llamarlos migrantes. A lo mejor llamar al migrante, trabajador migratorio, llamarlo simplemente trabajador internacional, y a las personas que nos llamamos o nos llaman inmigrantes, que a veces uno utiliza ese lenguaje por cuestiones de la definición, pero hay que empezar a deconstruirlos como se está haciendo, por ejemplo, con el concepto de migración en tránsito y otros. Tenemos que empezar a cambiar el chip, la lectura. O sea, cuando llamamos migrante a alguien, estamos nombrando una otredad. Que eso lo tenemos que cambiar. Eso ya lo han dicho muchos, Sandro Mesadra, Javier de Lucas, varios que han tratado de avanzar en esto de construir conceptos. Y creo que eso sí lo podemos hacer desde la academia.
Bueno, gracias. Muchísimas gracias. Gracias. Vamos a agradecerle a las panelistas por sus ponencias tan importantes.